these lips. We're made for selecting these hips. We're made for connecting these legs. We're made for wrapping around you so tight. Olay, every night when you see me dancing on the floor, you'll agree I'm class to the core. When you see me dancing with the boys, you'll agree you've never seen such porn.
Hello and welcome to TCM Slumberground, the pre-show party for TCM Underground, which airs every Friday night, late night on Turner Classic Movies. My name is Milita Chirico. I'm the programmer for TCM Underground. And as always, I am joined by my esteemed TCM colleagues, Matthew, Ben, and let's welcome our new square, Taryn. So I have a feeling that this episode is going to be simply divine. Tab Hunter and divine, that is. We are going to discuss the two films that they starred in together, starting with the premiere of Paul Bartel's Lust in the Dust from 1984. And of course, Polyester from 1981, directed by John Waters. Matthew, you know what to do. Why don't you give us a brief synopsis of Lust in the Dust?
So Lust in the Dust is the story of Rosie Velez, played by none other than Divine, who descends upon the New Mexico town of Chile Verde with a mysterious man with no name-esque gunslinger named Abel Wood, played by Tab Hunter. And they wind up at a saloon run by Margarita, played by Lainey Kazan. And it's loosely about all of these characters trying to sort of double cross and backstab each other to find some buried treasure, using these hidden clues to the treasure's whereabouts. So that's taking place amidst this love triangle between Rosie, Margarita, and Abel, and apparently on the set of Duel in the Sun, which is a Western from 1946 starring Gregory Peck and Jennifer Jones, that this is sort of spoofing. Gregory Peck leaned over to Jennifer Jones while they were filming a scene and said, oh, this should be called Lust in the Dust, for how lurid it was. And that became sort of an inside joke that became part of the lore around Duel in the Sun. And when it came time for Tab Hunter to get this project off the ground, he actually changed the title from The Reverend and Rosie to Lust in the Dust as sort of a nod to that film.
Good choice.
Yeah.
We are definitely going to talk about the connection between Duel in the Sun and Lust in the Dust a little bit later. But I think it's really fascinating that when this movie came out in 1984, Tab Hunter was in the middle of this big career resurgence. Ben, I was hoping that maybe you could talk a little bit more about how that happened.
Yeah, so it kind of happened like after Tab Hunter had kind of run through his like teenage heartthrob years of like the 50s and early 60s, and had kind of been replaced by the counterculture, New Hollywood. And so by the 70s, he was doing a lot of like touring around the country, doing dinner theater. And so by the time that he like got to the 80s, he wasn't really working much in film, doing a lot of TV stuff. And John Waters reached out to him to do Polyester. And, you know, he was like, I'm not doing anything else. This sounds fun. I think it speaks to like what is really lovable about Tab Hunter is that he was like, this sounds fun. I want to do this. So, you know, he doesn't take himself seriously. And so it kind of like set him off to like a second like career resurgence. Everybody's extracurricular activity for this double feature should be to watch the Tab Hunter Confidential documentary and the I Am Divine documentary. Like, it's a great pairing with these two.
Yeah. Big fans of Tab here at TCM Slumberground. So another thing about Lust in the Dust that I think is really interesting too, is that this was essentially the only movie that Divine did without John Waters. Taryn, can you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, so I didn't really know what to expect going into this because I hadn't really seen Divine outside of the realm of a John Waters movie before. So it was actually really fun. And I felt like it was the same Divine that I know and love. And to see Divine starring alongside Lainey Kazan was weird, but cool. And they actually kind of looked like sisters.
Yeah.
To me, I mean, they really did. It was fun to also recognize a lot of the characters and the actors from roles that they had played in other things and sitcoms, like the Big Ed character played by Nedra Voles. She was like the housekeeper in Different Strokes.
Yeah.
What's all that noise out there?
Is this Saturday? Lynch time.
mind.
There are some amazing lines in Lust in the Dust, like when Lainey Kazan's character Margarita is talking about jingle bobs, where she's like,
nice pair of jingle bobs.
Thanks.
I was unclear about what jingle bobs were. Like, I was like, are we looking at his boots? And I've never heard spurs called jingle bobs.
Oh, I love those jingle bobs. Yeah.
When he's naked on the bed and she comes in with the scissors, she says, if you move, I'm going to cut off your jingle bobs.
So. It's north of the boots. It's in the bathing suit area.
South of the belt, north of the boots.
Yeah.
Oh, that should be the tagline of the movie.
I think it was initially offered to John Waters to direct, but that he didn't want to direct something that he didn't write. So I think he turned it down. And quite honestly, like, Paul Bartel is the only other option when it comes to this. Because, you know, speaking of fans, he's got some here at TCM Slumberground for sure. We have talked about him before. You know, it's interesting because, it's very similar to a John Waters movie in a lot of ways. I think it's not as outrageous as some of John Waters' films, but it does have this incredible, you know, tie to Duel in the Sun, which... if anybody has not seen Duel in the Sun, starring Jennifer Jones and Gregory Peck, I urge you to see that movie because it is totally insane. But Divine and Lainey Kazan, I feel like, are intentionally trying to be the Jennifer Jones character from Duel in the Sun. So there's this great, like, kind of camp homage or something going on, which I think is a Paul Bartel thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's Paul Bartel without Mary Warnoff and Divine without John Waters.
And Divine snapping a lot of necks with inner thighs.
And I was thinking about this movie too, about Divine's career. Like, it made me kind of remember that, like, oh, like, he did have this whole other thing that he did without John Waters. You know, he like joined the Coquettes in San Francisco. He had like a high energy, like, disco career of like releasing records and stuff. And so like he did a lot of work and he kind of became a talk show personality, which is like not really a thing anymore, but like was in the 80s. You know, you can make the talk show circuit. And so like he was doing a lot of that in between the John Waters movies. And it's something you don't see because it's not in his filmography.
And also the following year, like I think it was in 1985, Divine had a disco hit, Walk Like a Man, where he's dressed in like full Western garb, which seemed so similar to Lust in the Dust to me, like directly inspired by this movie. So that was really interesting.
Yeah, I think Divine for sure seemed to be very much with this movie, especially kind of on the cusp of really, I think, making it even bigger than the John Waters movies. Just, you know, I think the reach of this one was just a little bit wider too. And I just think, man, if Divine had just lived, you know, a little longer, I think, you know, you would have really blown up.
Polyester kind of started the trajectory for John Waters and for Divine to kind of like move into legitimate cinema, you know, and kind of out of the underground. And so it's interesting to see that, you know, he wanted to play roles as real women and not trash monsters that, you know, like that he had become known for. So,
well, maybe that's a good segue then to our second film, which I know we're going in reverse chronological order with this one, but it's still a classic. We are going to talk about Polyester from 1981. And Taryn, would you do us the honor of giving us a little synopsis of this movie?
Yes. So Polyester is a melodrama satire that stars Divine as Francine Fishpaw. She is a suburban Baltimore housewife who has a very keen sense of smell, and she's on the verge of a nervous breakdown. She has a total sleazebag of a husband who owns an X-rated theater in their neighborhood, and he's cheating on her with his secretary, played by Mink Stole. So in true melodrama fashion, Francine's two teenage kids are some of the most defiant creatures in her life. I mean, they are causing her immense stress. So just when Francine is about to snap, along comes a heartthrob of a love interest played by Tab Hunter, Todd Tomorrow. But Todd's not all he's cracked up to be. So there's deception involved, and the drama just continues to escalate in ways that only a writer-director like John Waters could conceive of.
Just your description was cracking me up. I love this movie so much.
So Polyester is essentially John Waters' first commercial film. You know, obviously he's got so many films in his career that he made as pretty much underground movies, but this one was made for New Line, which had essentially just become a production company, and he got a little bit more of a budget. So Ben, what do you think about the way that Polyester looks with this in mind?
I love the Trash Trio, but I'm also like really glad that he kind of graduated and got to do new things. It's such a fun send up of like the Douglas Sirk melodrama era. I love that they got like a real set for this time. You know, I mean, they went to like the suburbs and got like a real house and dressed it up in this French provincial style, which I'm obsessed with. I love it. They got a theme song like written by like Chris Stein from Blondie that Tab Hunter sings. And like just to hear him sing the words French provincial.
French provincial.
Sends chills down my spine, and it gets me like so excited to watch the movie. It brings his like campiness up to like a whole nother level that he continues to do later on with Hairspray and Crybaby and stuff. And so I love it.
I think, you know, John Waters starts out with these really subversive movies, right? And then as he gets more budget, he starts releasing these movies that hit more audiences. And it becomes almost kind of like the most subversive things he can do is make something that's like fairly innocuous. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like he would later do that with Hairspray. That's like a, I think, PG rated movie. So it's like, you know, the most subversive thing you can do is just hit them with something that doesn't on the surface seem really subversive, but it is. Although I think this movie is a little bit leaning toward, you know, the more sort of earlier movies, more so than Hairspray, but it's just kind of an interesting thing I think that happened with him when it came to budget, for sure.
I love the parallels that John Waters draws that are direct references to like Douglas Sirk movies and the golden age of the, you know, the classic Hollywood melodrama during the 1950s. Movies like All That Heaven Allows, Magnificent Obsession, All I Desire, There's Always Tomorrow, all of these movies, there's like these specific themes that John Waters is referencing. One being like the woman in the unfortunate situation that she, you know, the odds are all stacked against her. Then the other is like family, just family chaos. And then another is like how the woman of the house confides in her housekeeper, who in this case is Cuddle. So it's the Edith Massey character. So you see he's doing direct throwbacks to those classics.
Edith Massey is the Agnes Moorehead of this movie.
Yeah.
Look at this dress, Francine. Isn't it Rosh Hashanah?
There's so many ties to the Douglas Sirk universe. I mean, the family lives on Wyman Way, which I think is really funny. And there's a scene of Francine wearing an all purple outfit, which Elizabeth Taylor frequently did. And I always think that she's basically the only person that can wear an all purple outfit. So I love these like little notes of reference to the melodrama 50s movie world, right?
I also love the scene where Tab Hunter and Divine get to go on a date together. And it's basically looks like a feminine hygiene commercial from the 70s where like this like slow rock song sung by Bill Murray. The fact that we get to see footage of Divine and Tab Hunter stroking a horse and running in slow motion in the field. I'm so grateful that that exists. It's such a great queer moment for film. And I'm so glad that John Waters put this together. Like it just warms my heart so much.
Yeah, well, speaking of heartwarming, I think my favorite thing about this movie is the relationship between Cuddles and Francine. It's just, it's such a sweet friendship. And it's something that I think is really unique to John Waters movies in that he reuses the cast so much and the same actors appear over and over again, especially in the early days, that it really gives them a chance to just play in this giant sandbox where they can really just play a completely different character from movie to movie. You know, characters like Mink Stole in this, you know, in this, she's like this, you know, BDSM mistress, you know, and then like, you know, the next movie, she might be this uptight woman getting obscene phone calls from, you know, Kathleen Turner. I just love that about his movies, that you can really just do whatever you want if you're an actor in his movies from movie to movie.
Speaking of Mink Stole, she always gets the best line in any John Waters movie. And I think that my favorite in this one is when she's talking about like Francine is like, I'm taking the kids. And she was like,
children would only get in the way of our erotic lifestyle.
To hear her say that with those like Bo Derek 10 cornrows is like, like, the movie just gives and gives. Like it does so much.
Yeah, I want to go back to something that Taryn said about the kids. The Fishpaw kids are essentially the children from All That Heaven Allows, except punk or something. Like, they're just as meddling and terrible as the kids in that movie. Yes. But Lulu Fishpaw is so great. My favorite aspect about Lulu is that she can't ever open a drink normally. She has to like spray it open like she's at the Super Bowl or something, and she's spraying it everywhere. Like, that character being just such a party girl is so funny to me. And her boyfriend is Steve Baters, who's like, you know, obviously like a punk rock legend, but the two of them together in that car is so scuzzy. It's so great. And Tab Hunter in this film, I mean, he's not in it for that long, if you think about it, but he makes such an impact. I mean, he's wearing those like tight jeans, and there's that scene where Francine is driving past him for the first time, and he's like leaning against the car, and he's kind of like, yeah, he's got his hand kind of over his crotch. And I was like, whoa, holy smoke. Like,
John Waters got his money out of him for that shot. Like, that's his introduction shot. Like, John Waters, like, I got Tab Hunter on the set. I'm going to have him against a Corvette and rubbing his crotch.
Yes. Love it. And of course, I think we would be remiss if we didn't mention that this film features a movie gimmick. Taryn, would you like to walk us through that a little bit?
So John Waters felt he needed a gimmick to help with box office appeal for Polyester. So he kind of looked to William Castle specifically from some of the in-theater gimmicks that William Castle did in the 50s and 60s for movies like The Tingler, 13 Ghosts, House on Haunted Hill. So what John Waters did was he put together a handy little scratch and sniff card that corresponded with numbers on screen. So it kind of brought you closer to the action in the movie, and it added another dimension to the film.
Can you imagine if Lust in the Dust had an Odorama card? I wonder what that would be like.
Well, maybe that's a good question for the group then. If Lust in the Dust had an Odorama card, what would the scents be? Starting with Ben.
One would be used pantyhose. Sweaty used pantyhose, I feel like, is a theme that came up a lot in Lust in the Dust. You can see people scratching away at that one.
Yeah. What about you, Matthew?
Chili Verde. Give up? Chili Verde. I think you got to have some scratch and sniff of the dish, Chili Verde. I think that'd be number two.
Yeah.
That's good. Well, what about you, Taryn? What's your pick?
I'm kind of leaning towards Divine's character Rosie's inner thighs, because I feel like they smell a little bit like a little musty, a little bit like danger. What about you, Millie?
I think my scent would obviously be tequila as poured over Lainey Kazan's chest.
100.
Yeah. I think this would pair well with the pouring of the V8 on Lucinda Dickey's chest in Ninja 3, The Domination. Well, that is about all the time that we have for this episode of TCM Slumber Ground. As always, I'd like to thank our esteemed TCM colleagues, Ben, Matthew, and Taryn. Great job. Definitely hope you come back. And hey, if you haven't done this yet, please like and subscribe to these videos. We love positive feedback. We also would love it if you perused all the other videos on the Turner Classic Movies YouTube channel. Also, if you are on Twitter, follow us. We're at TCM Underground. Until next time, smell you later.
Polyester, this is your life, Francine. Smell the fragrant perfume.